Okay.
Video's on. Okay, folks, I believe this is where we left off. Yes, no, maybe so?
Yes, maybe.
We did this previous one where we talked about the boiling point of N octadecane, and then we said we're done?
Yes.
Good, okay. All right, so let's change gears and talk about isomers. So this is something that you would have hit in 2A, but there are a few of us who have taken a break between 2A and 2B, and some of us just weren't listening. So let's talk about isomers one more time to remind ourselves what those things are. We're going to talk about that a lot in 2B, the different types of isomers. So the basic type of isomer is called a structural isomer or a constitutional isomer. So those two words can be used interchangeably. And what this is a couple of molecules that have the same molecular formula. So you can see up here butane and isobutane. They're both C4H10. So if we wrote the molecular formula C4H10, you wouldn't know if we meant butane or isobutane. But if we write out the structure of it, whether we have this full structural formula or the condensed formula like is shown in the picture right there, then you can see which one it is. So these have the same molecular formula, the same number of carbons and hydrogens, but they have a different atom connectivity. So they have a different connection of the atoms. So with this one right here, you have all of the carbons bonded to each other in a row. And see how this says H3C right here, folks? That is exactly the same as CH3. Just sometimes chemists write it here like that to just let you know that those hydrogens are out there and not in here. And because we just like to switch things up on you, so you're like, ah, right? No answer. Okay. So anyways, you can see that in isobutane, you don't have all the carbons lined up in a row, which is called a straight chain. What you have is you kind of have a central carbon right here, and the other carbons are bonded to it. Now, if I drew these out in the full structural formula, it would look a little bit different. What we would see, hold on, I have to log back in. I need to really switch the time on that so it keeps, doesn't keep putting on the lock screen for me. Okay, so what we would see here is if I drew this out in a full structural formula, there is not stuck like that. And it definitely is not between a couple of cartons. If I draw it out like this, can you see what this means, folks? We're good with that? Yes, no, maybe so? Okay. What about this one? Do you need me to draw all the carbons and hydrogens and all the bonds, or can we visualize what this looks like? You okay with that? Anyone need me to draw it out, full structure? Okay, good, good. Now, these are definitely different molecules, and how we know that is they have different chemical characteristics. So if we take a look at the boiling point right here, so I should correct that and say chemical and physical characteristics. Take a look at the boiling point, which is just one of our characteristics. We can see that butene has a boiling point, so it goes from a liquid to gas at minus 0.5 degrees Celsius. Whereas isobutane boils, it goes from liquid to gas at negative 11.7 degrees Celsius. So those are definitely different compounds. They're not the same thing. Does that make sense to us, folks? Okay. Let's do a few questions. So number one says draw two isomers with the formula C2H6O. Now in this class we're going to use Lewis structures a lot. So if you don't remember how to do Lewis structures, there are a couple of 2A review videos that are on our Canvas shelf in our website. And they're there for you guys to go through and review it, just in case you didn't catch it the first time or it's been a while since you've done these. All right, so C2H6O, does anyone want to try that? Try drawing a structure for that one? No, you guys are shy, you just want me to do it for you? Oh, my friend, my friend. Go ahead, tell me what you would do.
First, the center, you put two carbons in the center.
Okay.
And also another, an oxygen to the side, because it's also involved. And
okay.
Hydrogens for both carbons.
How many hydrogens on each carbon?
So there are three for each carbon.
So that N carbon has three. What about that second carbon? Does everyone like this structure?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So if we remember the octet rule, we can see that we've got 2, 4, 6, 8 electrons around that carbon. For this carbon, we've got 2, 4, 6, 8. And for all of our hydrogens, we have our duet. We have 2. Do you folks remember octet duet?
Yeah.
We're good there.
H2O.
What's that?
An example
of H2O. Yes. Yes. Exactly. Okay, that oxygen right there. Sometimes we'll see the molecule written like that, but if we want to show more detail, what you'll often see is a couple of lone pairs on that oxygen. Because oxygens like to have 2 bonding pairs and 2 lone pairs. So we see that habit when we take a look at water. Do you guys remember the Lewis structure for water right here at the top there? So for oxygen, we've got 2 bonding pairs, and we've got 2 lone pairs. And remember, a single bond is 2 electrons. You guys remember that? Okay, so it's a bonding pair of electrons, but the other ones are lone pairs. Carbons, they like to have 4 bonding pairs and no lone pairs. Carbons don't like lone pairs. So here you can see that all 4 of the pairs are bonding pairs, or bonds, single bonds. Same with this one right here. What do hydrogens like to do? They just like one single bond. They like a bonding pair. Pair of electrons is what I mean, okay? Hydrogens don't like lone pairs. They don't like double bonds. They don't like triple bonds. They're good with their little duet right there. Is this sounding familiar from 2A when you were asked to draw structures?
Yeah.
Do you remember you had to look at the periodic table and figure out how many valence electrons each atom brought to the table and then distribute them? So you had to count them up. Is that kind of ringing a bell, folks? So each carbon would bring with it 4 valence electrons, each hydrogen would bring with it 1 valence electron, Does anyone remember how many valence electrons oxygen brings?
Six.
And we knew this because we looked at the periodic table and we figured it out that way. Again, folks, if you've forgotten this, there are a couple of lecture videos from 2A that I put on our 2B Canvas shell, okay? If you need me to point you to them, I can do that, but there should be a module that says videos and they're in there, okay? All right, so this is one isomer of C2H6O. Can anybody tell me a different way you might connect the atoms that would still be C2H6O? Yes, sir.
The oxygen in the center and then the carbon on the sides and on that one.
Yes. So I put the oxygen in the center and the carbons on the side. And where would you put your hydrogens?
Three on each of the carbons.
Three on each of the carbons. Perfect.
And two on the pairs on the oxygen.
Good. Okay. Now, can you folks see that your atoms are doing what they like to do? The carbon over here and the carbon over there are doing exactly the same thing. And they have 2, 4, 6, 8, so they have their octet, and what they like to do is have four bonding pairs of electrons, also called a bond. Okay, so four bonding pairs on each side, and oxygen is doing what it likes to do. It has two bonding pairs and two lone pairs. Does that make sense, folks? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay, I'm gonna run through this one time, just to jog our memory on how we were doing that. And what we did was we said, okay, let's list our atom and let's list our valence electrons that each of those atoms brings. And we have carbon times two, and each carbon brings how many valence electrons with it, folks?
Four.
So we have four times two, which is eight. And then we have hydrogen, and we've got six of those. So have something times six, and hydrogen is bringing with them how many valence electrons? One. And if you're like, where are these people getting this from? We got it off the periodic table. That's how we learned it. We're like, okay, in this column, these have one valence electron, and this column, there's two. You guys kind of sort of remember that? Okay, awesome. So we have one times six, which is what?
Six.
Okay, then we have oxygen. How many do we have? One, and oxygens bring with them how many valence electrons?
Six.
Yes, so that's six. So we have 8 plus 12, which is what?
20.
20 valence electrons for this structure. Okay, so your first two rules where everything needs an octet, except for hydrogen, which needs a what?
A duet.
And then you have to use the number of valence electrons, and it has to be exactly this number, and that number will be different for every molecule. And then in my class, the way I teach it is then third, you want to look at the structure and make sure your different atoms are doing what they like to do, which is carbon likes to have four bonding pairs, oxygen two bonding pairs or two lone pairs, blah, 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 blah. Okay. All right, so we've got 20 valence electrons possible. So we look at this and we make sure all of our atoms have an octet or a duet. Do they, folks?
Yes.
Yes, and then you would have gone 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20. Is this a winner?
Yes.
Yes, so you know that is a valid structure. And then for the other isomer, you've got to do that also to make sure that it's a valid structure. So you would go, okay, octet, 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 all my hydrogens have a duet, and then 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, is this a valid structure?
Yes.
Yes, okay, so you've got two valid structures for C2H6O, so you've got a set of isomers here. These are definitely different molecules. This one right here is ethanol, also called ethyl alcohol. This is our drinking alcohol. Okay, the stuff that's in our alcoholic beverages. This over here is called dimethyl ether. This is definitely not something you want to be drinking on Friday night, folks, okay? Completely different chemical, physical, oops, I lost my shoe there, characteristics, but they both have the molecular formula of C2H6O. Are we okay with what isomers are, folks?
Yeah.
We kind of sort of remember how to draw valence, Lewis structures?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay. So again, the lectures are there for you if you've forgotten how to do. All right, number two. Which of the following molecules are isomers? Anyone want to take a stab at it?
All three.
All three. They're all C5H12. Can you guys see that? Okay. But the atoms are connected or they're bonded in a different way. But they all have a molecular formula of C5H12. Are we okay with that? But they're all gonna have different characteristics, right? Different boiling points, melting points, electrical conductivity, density, blah, 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 blah. Questions for me?
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Why are all three different names even though they're the same?
So they have the same molecular formula, but they're different molecules. So they need to have a different name. And if a molecule has a different name from another molecule, usually that means they're different molecules. Okay? I say usually because sometimes that the first one up here, we call this one ethanol. Sometimes we call it ethyl alcohol, but that's just an old name and a new name. Doesn't mean they're different. Get what I mean? Okay. Questions for me? Concerns? Complaints? Woohoo! No complaints. Okay, so let's get into nomenclature. How did we know how to name these things down here? Well, let's learn that. Okay? So, we have a standard way that we name things. And who set this up? Well, it was a group called and that is the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry. So IUPAC makes a lot of the rules that we're going to use in this semester. So it's also called substitutive nomenclature because we might pull a hydrogen off of our hydrocarbon and stick a different atom there. So we've substituted a different atom for the hydrogen. So that's the substitutive part of it. And rules for alkane nomenclature extend to most other compound classes. So what we'll do in this class, usually we'll start a new chapter. We'll talk a little bit about the types of molecules we're gonna see in that chapter. And a lot of times I have little samples for you guys to smell, which is kind of fun. And then we talk about how to draw them, how to name them, and then we do reactions. And it's kind of like that over and over for quite a few chapters, all right? So things that you learn in this chapter are going to carry on for the entire semester. So it's pretty important that you learn how to name things and draw things because it'll keep coming back to haunt you every chapter if you don't. So if you don't know how to draw Lewis structures very well, please go watch those videos and get good at it. Is that clock loud or is it just because it's like coming at me like at a certain angle or something? It just seems like it's like loudly ticking. Okay, so unbranched alkanes are named according to their numbers of carbons. And by branched, what we mean is, see how this carbon right here, all the other ones are CH2, 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 but in this one of the hydrogens has been pulled off and we've put something else there. That's a branch, okay? It's what we call a branch or a substituent in organic. All right, so branch and substituent, same thing. So we've learned methane, ethane, propane, butane, pentane, and hexane. So we name them by the number of carbon. Number two says if you have a branch on your hydrocarbon chain, or sometimes we call it the straight chain, or the parent chain, or the principal chain, what you want to do is you want to find the longest continuous carbon chain that you have. So that means the longest carbon chain without picking up your pencil. So you can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 1, 2, 3, 4, like that. And the longest one is what? 6. And again, continuous means you're not picking up your pencil and the carbons are connected. So the longest continuous carbon chain there would be 6 carbons long. Now, a lot of times the molecule will be drawn differently to try to fool you, especially in this chapter when we're getting used to how to name things, how to draw things. So you definitely have to remember to look for the longest continuous carbon chain. So with this one, if you did 1, 2, 3, 4, you would miss the fact that you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. And the black print indicates that this is actually the branch right here. These two molecules are exactly the same thing, and I built it for you. Oh, but this one's missing a hydrogen. Let me steal from this other molecule. So what we have here is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So that's the purple chain right here, or pink. And then on carbon number 3, so 1, 2, 3, let me put it this way so it's matching up to what you guys see. So 1, 2, 3, we have this little branch down here. So you guys okay with that? And also, we're going to draw it straight on paper, but in space, and I don't mean like outer space, like there's space here, the molecules are not exactly straight and flat. Each one of these carbons is going to have a tetrahedral arrangement. Do you guys remember that from the geometry portion of 2A, molecular geometry? Okay. So they all have a tetrahedral arrangement. So you get this like little mountain and valley looking thing, or caterpillar looking thing. So anyways, so it looks like that. And if I remember that single bonds have a free rotation, so these guys can do this, and they do all day long, then we can match this up with this and see that it's the exact same molecule. So let's stick that out there. We've got 3 up here. So 1, 2, 3. So we've got 1, 2, 3. And then we see down here that we've got 1, 2, 3. So we got 1, 2, 3. So it's kind of hard to like. Anyways. Okay. Stick that out there. Ah! I heard that sigh. There we go. Okay. So can you guys kind of sort of see it? They're like, please move on. We can see it. Anyways, the point is they're the same molecule. And if you had to make a model of it and move it around and match it up, you would see that because of the free rotation around the single bonds, that it's the same thing. Okay, so we want to make sure that those two things have the same name. Questions for me, folks? Yes?
I actually did one of those kind of models called marshmallows.
That would be very fun.
Yeah, I didn't want the video because this was kind of COVID.
Okay, who did that for 2A?
That's how I took out the model. It was fun.
It was a good class?
Yeah, but the lab was also
on. Oh, that's not fun. But you made it through, right? Okay.
How did you count the one over to the right with your, like, without moving the pencil? Which one was longer?
Like this.
Oh, okay. Okay.
And then this would be the branch. And for this one, that's the parent chain, and that's the branch. So, yeah. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. You know, I didn't pick it up at all. Does that make sense, guys?
Mm-hmm.
You okay with that? Okay. So rule number 3 says if you have two chains that are equal in length, like say you have six carbons and you have the choice between having one or two or three branches, you want to select the one with the most substituents. So what on earth did I just say? Well, okay. Taking a look at this first one right here, if we were to say we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, we have two options there. Which one are we gonna go with? Well, the first one, if you pick this as the parent chain, right here, that would be a branch. So it is hanging off your parent chain. You've got one branch there. Now, if you go with the, just losing my shoe today. If you go with the straightly drawn one, the pink one here, which is also six carbons, what you can see is with this six carbon chain, you have two branches. So what IUPAC says is to make everything standard, we're gonna make the rule that because you have two options, you're gonna go with the six carbon chain that has two branches rather than the six carbon chain that has one branch. Is that clear for us? Any questions on that? Let me put circles around the branches just so you can visualize it better. No, you do not have to write circles around your branches. Okay. So that would be your one branch off of your six carbon blue parent chain. And here are your two branches off of your six carbon pink parent chain. Okay, does that make sense, folks? If you had a five carbon chain versus a six carbon chain, which one would you pick?
Six.
And it wouldn't matter the branches, but the fact is you have a choice between two different six carbon chains here. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, so number four says, then what you guys are gonna do is you're gonna number the principal chain, or remember principal chain and parent chain and longest continuous carbon chain are the same thing. Giving the lower number to the first branching point. So if we were to say, okay, I've got this molecule right here. I have identified that the six carbon chain is my longest continuous chain. Now I need to number it. Do I want to number it left to right or right to left? And most of us, because we write in English, we want to write left to right. And just in case you didn't know, there are other languages that write right to left or up to down or up down into the left. Isn't that interesting? No comment. Okay, anyways, so if we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 this way, we can see that our branch right here is coming off of carbon 4. If we number backwards, we can see that this branch right here is coming off of carbon number 3. And IUPAC says that you want to keep the numbers as low as possible. So you will number your parent chain backwards so that your branch right here is off of carbon 3 rather than off of carbon 4. Okie dokie, smokies? Okay. So, what is the name of our parent chain here, folks? Yep, that's hexane. Because it has how many carbons? Six. And last week I said you guys should learn your hydrocarbon chains. So methane, ethane, propane, butane, pentane, hexane. Remember those, friends? You're going to use them all semester. Now, you can see that we've chosen to go this direction, and we have a branch off of carbon 3. So it can't just be hexane, because that branch could be off of carbon 3, or it could be off of carbon 2, and we would have an isomer. So we have to get a little more specific than just hexane. What is that branch? What do we call it? And where is it located on our chain? And that's what we're gonna do. So when we looked at our isomers before, and we saw that they had different names, and they had numbers in them and other stuff up at the front. That's what the naming is doing, okay? It's telling you where the branch is, and it's telling you what the branch is. Now, let's take a look at our different branches. Which is right, okay? So that CH3 that was hanging off of carbon number 3, what on earth is that called? Well, that's called a methyl. And methyl, which is right here, it gets its name from methane. So remember, methane is this molecule right here. Okay? So what we do is we say, well, that carbon right there can't have 5 bonds. So we have to rip off one of the hydrogens if we want to bond it to the parent chain. And if we rip off one of the hydrogens, then it's going to be CH3 instead of CH4. And that line right there, that's just indicating that it's bonded to something. Is it bonded to a hexane, a heptane, an octane? We don't care at this point because we're just saying it's bonded to something. And it's always going to be called methyl, no matter what it's bonded to, if it's CH3. Does that make sense, folks?
Yeah.
Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay, so what we do is we take the ane off of methane and we replace that with YL, so you pronounce that methyl. Now, see how it's off to the side like that in this example, but in this example, it's hanging below the molecule? It doesn't matter, okay? So you could have drawn this on top, or you could put this parent chain like down like that and hang the methyl off to the right or to the left. If it is a CH3 and it's bonded to something else, it's called a what? Starts with an E and ends with ethyl. Sorry, an M. I said E. I was thinking ahead for ethyl. Starts with an M and ends with ethyl. Methyl. Yeah, that's how that was supposed to go. Sorry. Okay, so it's a methyl. And then this one right here, that one comes from ethane. Ethane looks like this. The other way you can draw it is like this. So if you pull off one of those hydrogens, what you're going to have is CH2CH3 with a little line on the end there, indicating that it's bonded to what? Something else, right? You can also draw it like this. How else can you draw it? Like that. Or like this. Have you maybe seen that before? Yes, you have. It's right there. You guys see that? This right here is which group? Starts with an M and ends with ethyl. Methyl, there, I got the joke right this time, right? And then this one's what? That one's ethyl. So can you see how that this could be drawn down below also? Yes, no, maybe so?
Yeah.
Yay, someone said yes. Okay, so we got the name from ethane, and we crossed out the ane and we added an O, and that became ethyl. Is that okay with you folks? Okay, the other way that you guys will see that is instead of CH2CH3, it's just drawn with the molecular formula, C2H5. That's an ethyl group also. Does that make sense to us? Yes, ma'am. This one right here, that's ethane. These ones over here, those are ethyl. Does that make sense? So we get ethyl from ethane. So that's where the name is coming from.
Okay.
And then we get the name methyl from methane.
Okay.
Now, if folks, this one right here, it has three carbons. So without cheating and looking over here, what is that one? It comes from propane, but it has one fewer carbon. So propane would have CH3, CH2, CH3. Propyl, okay? So we would take the ane off of propane and we would call it propyl. Okay, so I've got a propane here. So it's got three carbons, and then we have CH3, CH2, CH3. So if this thing right here wants to bond to something else, this carbon on the end right here, it already has four bonding pairs. It already has an octet. It's happy. It's not just going to bond to something else. What you have to do is you have to pull the hydrogen off. So then you have CH3, CH2, CH2, and then this bond right here that wants to bond to something else, and that would be this right here. Are we okay with that, folks? Okay, so it goes from propane with its hydrogen on it, and we pull the hydrogen off, and then it's called a what? Propyl. Are we okay with this, folks? Yes, no, maybe so? Okay. Now, if I had four carbons, and I stole the hydrogen for this molecule, so now I have to steal the hydrogen and put it back on. If I have four carbons, what's this thing called? Cigarette lighter. Butane. This is called butane. So I had methane, ethane, propane, butane. So this is the butane. If I pull a hydrogen off the end, now it's a what?
Butyl.
Now it's a butyl. And now it can bond to something else. Are we okay with that? Yay! Okay, so moving on. In case you just tuned out, there's a little chart. I need you folks to memorize a few things. We rarely ask you to memorize things, but with these ones, it's gonna serve you for the rest of the semester because we're gonna see them over and over and over and over, and it's just best if you know them. So I need you guys to know methyl, ethyl, propyl, butyl, isopropyl, and skip down to tert-butyl. Isobutyl and sec-butyl I don't need you guys to memorize, but the other ones, trust me, you will use them over and over and over and over. Just makes it quicker if you know them. isopropyl. Isopropyl, instead of being drawn this way in the condensed formula, you'll often see it drawn like that or like that. It looks like a little snake tongue. So if you see the snake tongue, you've got an isopropyl. Now, why isopropyl instead of propyl? Well, with propyl, what you have is you have the hydrogen being stolen off end carbon right there. So you can see how that CH3 on the end was made into CH2. Isopropyl, it also has three carbons and seven hydrogens, so 3, 6, 7, or 3, 5, 7, so both have three carbons, seven hydrogens, except the hydrogen was stolen off the center carbon there. So you're connecting this three carbon chain from the center carbon and isopropyl and the terminal or end carbon with the propyl. So do you see the difference between propyl and isopropyl? Okay, in propyl you're connecting to the end carbon. In isopropyl you're connecting something or stealing the hydrogen off of the center carbon. Are we okay with that? The little difference there? Kind of, sort of, maybe? Okay, awesome. Now, down below, tert-butyl. This is often called T-butyl. I rarely see it written out as tersbutyl or said as tersbutyl, it's usually called T-butyl. Now, the name says butyl, so that should indicate to you that it has how many carbons?
Four.
A butane has how many carbons?
Four.
A butyl has how many carbons? Four. A T-butyl has how many carbons? Four. A sec-butyl has how many carbons? And an isobutyl has how many carbons? Four. So if you've got butyl, butene, that butte part of it, it's telling you to have how many carbons? Four. Do you guys see that? Okay. Why the iso and the sec and the T? We'll get to that. Don't worry. All right. Now the T-butyl, you'll often see it written as a T. So sometimes it's drawn out like that, and then a lot of other times it's just represented as a T. And don't worry, we will see that when we draw molecules and name molecules. It will come back. Yay! Aren't you excited? Okay, no answer. Right on. Any questions on this slide for me? No. Okay. So let's put all of those rules together. And if you're like, what on earth is this stuff? Don't worry, you will do it so many times in here that by the time you walk out at the end of the semester, you will be a pro at this. Just because you'll do it over and over and over and over and over. Okay? All right, so looking at this molecule right here, we wanted to find the longest continuous carbon chain, and we decided that that was six carbons long. And we also decided that the parent chain, also called the principal chain, was called what? Hexane. All right, so it's some form of hexane, but it has a branch on it, so you can't just call it hexane because it's different than a regular old hexane. So we said, okay, then you have to number it. And do you want to number it left to right or right to left? And we decided we wanted to do right to left because that would put that CH3 on carbon number 3 rather than on carbon number 4. Is everybody okay with why we numbered it the direction we numbered it? Good?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that means we located the branch and we located it at carbon number 3. So that branch not only is called methyl, but we have to put the location. And so it's not just methyl, it's 3-methyl. And then we squish those two things together and we say we have a 3-methyl hexane. Us a lot of information. What we see is that we have a 6-carbon parent chain. And on that 6-carbon parent chain, we have a branch. What is the branch? It is methyl. Where is the methyl located? Well, it's on carbon number 3. Are you guys all right with that? Now, when you have a number and a letter next to each other, IUPAC says that you put a hyphen between them. So we have 3-hyphen methyl, and then there's no space here, hexane. Okie dokie smokies? Right. Questions for me? Okay, so we just did the next part. We put the name together. So in case you tuned me out, number 6 says you can construct the name by first putting the location of your branch or branches, the name of your branch or branches, and then the parent chain, making sure that if you have a number next to a letter, there's a hyphen between them. Questions for me?
This one, yes. We do parentheses.
We will do parentheses? Yes, we will. But not yet. Okay? Yes, sir, in the back.
So, if there was multiple branches,
food would only go out for the very first time.
You have to say what the branch is, how many of them you have, and what the location is on each of them. And don't worry, those are my next examples. And we'll learn. It's not that bad. But first, let's take a look at these problems right here. Does anyone want to do the first one? Okay, so looking at what's my longest continuous chain? You could do 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. You could also do 1, 2, 3, or 1, 2, 3. You don't do 1, 2, 3, 4. So you have to pick up your pencil to do that. So that one doesn't count. We don't have a 4-carbon continuous chain here. We just have 3, 3, 3, 3. Any which way we go, it's gonna be 3, right, friends? So most people will go, okay, I've got a 3-carbon chain here, and that means my parent is called what? Think of a barbecue. Propane, good friends. Okay, so your parent chain is propane. Now the question is, which parent chain are we gonna pick? Which 3-carbon chain? And most of us will do that one right there because it's left to right and we read in English and, like, you know what I mean? Okay, so the next question is, do you want a number forwards or backwards? Because you've got a branch right there. So does it matter if we say 1, 2, 3 or 1, 2, 3?
No.
Nope, in this one it doesn't because it's symmetrical. So if you number it left to right, your branch is off of which carbon? Carbon number 2. If you number right to left, that branch is off of carbon number what? 2. Either way, so on this one it doesn't matter, but for most of us, we like to go left to right if given the option, right? No, left. No, I'm kidding. Okay. So what we're gonna have is a 2-something because our branch is located at carbon number 2. So in writing the name, let's put the branch here, we would say 2-what? What is that branch that I circled there? Methyl, good. Now is it 2-methylpropane or promethyl, sorry, promethyl? Propane 2-methyl. Yes, we've got 2-methylpropane. Right there. Are we okay with that one, folks? Okay. Now we could also have said that our parent chain is this right here. And this CH3 right here is the branch, but what you'll see is that you still have a 2-methylpropane because the branch that I circled is still methyl and it's still on the carbon. Carbon 2, so that's still 2-methylpropane. You also could have done this. And let's number it a weird way this time. Let's do that. That would be called what?
2-methylpropane.
You can do all that business because this is such a symmetrical molecule. So I just wanted you guys to see that. All right. Does anyone want to try the one on the top right?
2-methyl.
I heard ethyl and a 3-ethyl and what else? Okay. So I hear that we're getting the branch correct, ethyl. And most of us would go, I like the branch to be the one that's hanging off of there. But let's back up and let's figure out what the parent chain is first. So if you're looking at that, you would be like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Seems like this is another symmetrical molecule, right? Yes, ma'am, maybe so?
Yeah.
So most of us would number left to right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, because intuitively we're seeing that any way we go, that branch is going to be off of carbon number what?
Three.
Three, okay, so we're getting kind of lucky with these. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Okay, so our parent is what? Pentane, good folks. And our branch is, it's ethyl, and the ethyl is located on carbon number 3, so that would be 3-ethyl. So putting that together, we would call it what?
3-ethyl.
Yes. 3-ethyl pentane. Making sure that we have a hyphen between the number and the letter, so 3-ethyl, and no space between ethyl and pentane. Anyone have a problem with that? Okay, good. Good, good. Because this is symmetrical, you could have also done 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And can you guys see that that would still be a 3-ethyl pentane? Yes, no, maybe so.
Yeah.
Can I number a different way? Could I do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5? And then have this be the branch right there. Would that be a 3-ethyl pentane? Yes, no, maybe so?
Yes.
This CH2, CH3, is that ethyl? Mm-hmm. Is this longest continuous chain 5 carbons?
Yes.
Is it off of the 3rd carbon, the branch off of carbon number 3? Yeah, it is. We just don't like to see it that way, right? We like the parent chain to be horizontal and the branches go up and down, right? But they'll be drawn like that, folks. Alrighty, let's go down to the bottom. Let me erase this just for the space. Anyone want to try the bottom left? No answer. Okay, that must mean you want me to do it for you. Okay, longest continuous carbon chain here. Most of us want to go left to right first. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay, there's 6 carbons there. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we have a 6-carbon chain, right, folks? Okay. So if we go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, that's the longest continuous carbon chain. We can see that we've got this little elbow here. And at every point and every end, we have a carbon. So we have a carbon here and a carbon here. If you have a 2-carbon branch, that's called what?
Ethyl.
Yay, from the back. Thank you. So we've got an ethyl hanging off of our parent chain, right, folks? Okay, so our parent here, we've decided is called what?
Hexane.
Hexane, because it has how many carbons?
6.
Yeah, that's 6. Did we decide how to number it yet? No. Well, someone did in their brain back there and said yes. We were like, what's that branch there? It looks different because it's drawn in the skeletal formula. So that's what I pointed out to you guys. But we hadn't done the numbering yet. So do we want to number it left to right or right to left?
Right to left.
Yes. Good. You guys picked that up right away. Because if that would give us 3 what? 3-ethyl. And if you stuff those 2 parts together, that would give you what?
3-ethyl.
Yes, 3-ethyl hexane. Now, if you numbered the other way, folks, so if we did the red number. Okay, so if we did left or right with the red numbers, what would be the problem? problem with numbering that way.
It's a higher number?
Yeah, it's a higher number where you have the branch. So that would be 4 ethyl hexane when you went to name it. And IUPAC says you want to stick with the one that has the lower number. You always want to give your branches the lowest number possible. Now, how did I know that this was ethyl right here? Well, we looked at skeletal structures last week, and we said wherever you have a point or an end, you have a carbon. Okay, does that make sense, folks? And then we assume you know how many hydrogens are on each carbon. With skeletal structures, you don't draw them in. I am drawing them in for you so you can visualize it. Now, with your skeletal structures, the common student mistake is to include a carbon from the parent chain. You don't want to do that. So the parent chain is down here, and this carbon right here that I'm pointing to, that is part of the parent chain. So you would not include it when you go to say to yourself, is this methyl ethyl propyl? What is this? So if you wanted to draw a little bubble for yourself, like I do there and there, it's always going to go across a bond between carbons. So what you would do is you say, okay, it's that right there. And you can see that CH2, CH3, so it's a what? It's an apple. Is there a different way you could have numbered this chain, folks? And have it be correct. Anyone want to try it? Could you have done 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 like that? So that's giving you hexane, right? Mm-hmm. Off of carbon number 3 right here, what do you have for your branch?
Ethyl.
Yeah, you have ethyl. So you see this right here? That would be CH2, CH3. You would have a 3 ethyl hexane. So there's a couple of different ways here you could have numbered things. Do you guys see that? Okay. And I'm pointing all of this stuff out to you because this is stuff that you will see. You'll encounter this, you'll see questions that ask you to do that type of thing. And so I want you to be aware that these things can be drawn in a multitude of ways. All right? Now, the next one, folks. Just looking at this one. What do you want to do with it?
Left to right.
Left to right? That's what we're usually going to default to, unless there's a branch that is like 20 carbons long. It's super obvious. So we would say 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. But if you go 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, or 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, that should be like ding, 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 ding. IUPAC says I have to go with how many carbons?
Six.
So you're either going to go from left to right going down, or you can come backwards and do that. Let's be weird and let's go backwards. Just cause. So we're going to do 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Is everybody okay with that? Yeah. Okay. Now that branch right here, and notice I go through a bond there between carbons, has how many carbons?
Two.
So you have a carbon at each point and each end. And then we have to assume how many hydrogens. So on the end one, the end carbon, you have how many hydrogens?
Three.
Because on our end carbons, we always have 3 hydrogens. And then this one's going to have 2. So you've got CH2, CH3. So that branch is who? Yeah, it's ethyl. Okay, so let's go ahead and just name it. So we have ethyl hanging off of which carbon of the parent chain?
3,
right there. So we have 3 ethyl what?
Hexane.
Yep. because our longest continuous carbon chain is 6 carbons long. Okie dokie, Smokies. Questions for me? Concerns? Complaints? Besides, is she going to take up every minute?
Mm-hmm.
Right? Okay, 157. Oh, I got lots of time to torment you. All right, drawing. Most students find drawing easier than naming. Or you just like drawing things. Okay, so we want to draw 4 isopropyl octanes. Okay, so octane, that is our parent chain. That has how many carbons, folks?
8.
I'm going to draw most things in here with a skeletal structure because it's easiest. And it's the way that you guys will lose the fewest points from hydrogen problems. And what I mean is often students will put a CH2 where they mean CH3 or vice versa. So my pen hits the paper and that's my first carbon. So I have 1, 2, 3, 4. Technology, don't do that. Okay, let's try that again. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And you could draw that upside down or you could turn it on its side so it's vertical. It doesn't matter. Is everybody okay with that? All your ends and all your points have carbons, and then we assume you know which carbons are CH3s and which ones are CH2s. Okie dokie, Smokies? All right. So does it matter at this point if you number forwards or backwards? No, it's your molecule. You can draw it how you want. And most of us are going to go left to right. Right, folks? Okay. So we're going to say there is a branch on carbon number 4. So we have 1, 2, 3. Oops. I don't know how to count. 1, 2, 4. What is that? 1, 2, 3, 4. So we've got a branch off of carbon number 4 there. And where I got that information was right there. Are we all right with that, folks? What is my branch?
Isopropyl.
And it says propyl, so that should be like, I've got 3 carbons, but the iso means it's somehow different. And back here, you've got a chart to tell you what these things look like. And remember we talked about the difference between a propyl and an isopropyl?
Mm-hmm.
Your isopropyl and your propyl, you both in both of those, you have 3 carbons. The difference is in a propyl, you're connecting to the end or the terminal carbon, whereas in the isopropyl, you're connecting where? In the center. You're connecting to that carbon right there. And when we draw it in a skeletal structure, I said to you guys, it's often going to look like a snake tongue. Okay? So, if we go back to the structure that we're drawing here, go to carbon number 4, and when the peak is pointing up, convention is that you draw the branch up. You don't want to draw it like in between the upside down V like that, just because that's the way to do it. So you connect it to carbon 4 and you put your little snake tongue in. So that's going to be a 4 isopropyl octane. Are you folks okay with this? If you need to see where the carbons are, you go to carbon here. Now those carbons on the end, here and here, how many hydrogens do they have? 3, because the ones on the end usually have 3, right? So if I drew them in, which I do not do with skeletal structures, but I'm doing it here just to show you how many, it would look like that. Now that center red carbon, how many hydrogens does it have?
2.
See how easy it is to make a hydrogen mistake? So a lot of you guys said 2 because you're used to CH2s being between CH3s, right? But this carbon right here, it is bonded to 3 different carbons. It's bonded to this carbon also. So it has 2, 4, 6 valence electrons around it already. So it doesn't have room to be bonded to 2 hydrogens. It only has room to be bonded to how many hydrogens? 1. So if we draw in its 1 hydrogen, You can draw it off to the left or the right or up, it doesn't matter. It would look like that, and then you could go, okay, now my carbon has 2, 4, 6, 8, which is the magic number, it's the octet. And you can also see that that carbon has 4 bonding pairs around it. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4 pairs. So does that make sense, folks? Why I'm kind of pushing you towards a skeletal structure? Oh yes. And if you look at the chart, you can also see that that central carbon, that's isobutyl. Well, the central carbon there has one hydrogen also. There we go. Come on, Ken. One hydrogen there. Does that make sense to us, folks? Mm-hmm. We're good? Yay! Okay, so when you have more than one substituent, like my friend in the back asked about, so you don't just have a lonely old methyl or a lonely old ethyl. When you have more than one branch, also called a substituent, we have to say how many there are. And how we do that is we use Greek prefixes. So if you have 2 methyls hanging off of your parent chain, you're gonna say dimethyl when you go to name it. If you've got 3, you'll use tri. If you've got 4, you'll use tetra. If you have 5, you'll use what? There we go, penta. Okay, so it's the Greek prefixes there. So in the first example, we have dimethyl. And in the second example right here, we also have dimethyl. The difference is in this molecule here, your branches are connected to different carbons of the parent chain. So this one would be connected to carbon 2, and this one will be connected to carbon 3. Whereas here, you have both of your methyls connected to the same carbon, carbon number 2. Does that make sense, folks?
Mm-hmm.
That's okay, either way. So if we were to name these, we would say, okay, this is the longest continuous carbon chain right here. It's 4 carbons, so the parent is going to be called what? 4 carbons. Methane. Methyl ethyl propyl. Methane, ethane, propene, butane. So this one is a butane. And our branches. What we have is we have a 2-methyl, and we also have a what? We have another methyl, but that's a 3-methyl, correct?
Mm-hmm.
And then IUPAC just told us that if you have 2 methyls, you're going to call that what? Dimethyl. So then the question is, what do I do with those numbers? Well, you're going to stick the numbers up front. And if you have 2 numbers next to each other, instead of a hyphen like we use between a number and a letter, we're going to use a comma. So what we say is if you've got a couple of them, that's going to become dimethyl. But that's a rule we just used. We just don't. And to name this thing, we're going to go ahead and stick the numbers up front with a comma between them. So we have 2, 3. And then we put a hyphen because we're going to have a letter next. And whenever you have a number and a letter together, you put a hyphen. So it's going to be 2,3-dimethyl, what, friends?
Butane.
So again, our parent is the butane. So we know it's a 4-carbon chain. And then this part right here tells us that you have 2 methyls hanging off your butane. Where are they located? Well, one of them is hanging off of carbon number 2, and the other one is hanging off of carbon number 3. And it is important that we locate them because a 2,2-dimethyl is different from a 2,3-dimethyl.
they're gonna have different properties, like boiling points, melting points, density, blah, 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 blah. So you have to be precise. What is it called? Are we okay with this, folks?
Yes.
Okay, so with my last 4 minutes, we're just gonna name the next one. So let's move on to this guy right here on the right. So can we see what the longest continuous carbon chain is there? Left to right, folks? Okay. So most of us would go with that one right there. Kind of intuitive on that. Yes, no, maybe so, friends? Okay. How many carbons is that?
Just one carbon.
Bicarbon chain is called what? Pentane. Good, folks. Okay, so my branches. What do I have?
Two.
I have a 2-methyl and a what?
2-methyl.
And a 2-methyl.
Okay.
So methyl and methyl becomes dimethyl. Are we all okay with that?
Mm-hmm.
If you've got 2 methyl groups on your parent chain, you have to say dimethyl. Now the next question is, what do we do with those numbers? And most of us are going to want to say 2-dimethylpentane. But there's a problem with that. And the problem is, you only located one of your methyls, but you told me you have 2 of them. And they're both on the same carbon of the parent chain, but you still have to give the location of both of them. Because if you do this, what it says is you have 2 methyls, but I'm just going to tell you where one of them is. So it could be 2,3-dimethylpentane, or it could be 2,2-dimethylpentane. So if you say 2,2-dimethylpentane, it means you've got 2 methyl groups, and they're both on carbon number 2. So you have to do 2,2-dimethylpentane. And that's a very common student mistake, and you'll see that on quizzes and tests, friends. And a lot of people will make the mistake of forgetting that second number because your branches are on the same carbon. So just keep that one in mind. Yes, sir?
Is that the methyl or dimethyl?
Is that 2,2-dimethyl? It's 2,2-dimethyl. It's an I. Oops, that was the eraser. 2,2-dimethyl. There you go. Any questions for me, folks? Okay. Those of you who have laughed today, please bring I haven't looked at anybody's work yet, but if you want to email me or pop into office hours, I can take a look and see.
I'll try to get you on office hours.
Is that the only thing I'm not working?
Okay, that sounds good. You can also email.